morning, Cheviot churches!
Morning.
And a very, very warm welcome. I hope you've all enjoyed your extra hour in bed. I see you wake early. We didn't have food. But anyway, welcome. And we have, I 2 weeks ago in Guild Sunday, and we were remembering how Marion and Tom were with us. And here they are again, all the way from Shetland, but they're looking for a house. So if you know of any houses in the Borders area, let them know. But Marion especially is here because of this shield. And if you're an avid reader of the Cheviot magazine, you'll be aware you have read Margaret's story about how she travelled to Australia. And she included that as for the national competitors competition. And she won. So we won't ask you to read at all today. But the shield is for her. Obviously, because of COVID, we can't have a handover or anything, but we're going to do it after the service and have a photo opportunity outside where we can take off masks and things like that. So welcome to Margaret, and welcome to Marion. Tom, Marion's no longer the... Is it convener, I keep? No longer the convener. She's handed that over, but... Things will be quieter, a little bit quieter. Good. The notices have been on the screen, they're on the web page. After the service, or at lunchtime, the video of the service is put up on the website and on Gordon's YouTube page. And next Sunday, we're having communion. So obviously it will be a bit different from usual, but we'll go through that next week. So next week, communion both here in Yetholm and in Warbattle. And also if anyone wants home communion that you're aware of, then please do let me know. But at the moment, I can go into homes in, and everything will be very, very clean and so on. So, and what else is happening? The church will be open on Wednesday morning between 10 and 12, as usual. I will be there. Presbytery is having, is holding a quiz night in aid of Tear Fund, and that will be the 13th of November. So more details I'll put on the webpage next week. That just came in yesterday. And I don't know if you want Strictly. You do, some of you do. Just, I was looking at it yesterday and suddenly making connections. And one of the contestants, is that what they're called? One of the dancer contestants is actually the son of a former moderator of the Church of Scotland and the present chair of the trustees. So JJ, who is the army veteran, his father was John Chalmers, who was moderator. So that just, you probably all knew that, but I didn't realize until yesterday that suddenly they came together. And I thought about that. So obviously I was watching Strictly. Let us have our call to worship. The wisdom of God calls to us from the heights, along the pass, and at the crossroads. Come into God's presence to worship and to pray. And from our scattered places we come, let us worship God. And if it's on there, you'll see I missed out the singing part, because obviously we can't sing, but we can listen. We can listen. And Heather's going to play for us part of in 465, Be Thou My Bishop. Your love is steadfast, your presence ever near. And yet you come to us in surprising ways and unexpected places. Your love is older than time, and yet as fresh as a morning dew. Your name comes to us down the centuries, and yet you can always do a new thing to draw us back to you. God, Creator, Christ and Spirit, we offer you our prayers and our praise this day in humble expectation, hoping you'll surprise us here and refresh our readiness to serve you. God, gracious and merciful, holy and healing, you know our hearts, the times that we've truly loved one another, and those times when we've merely tolerated each other. You know our minds, the times that we've truly focused on you, and the times when we pursued our own purposes. You know our stories, the times that we followed you faithfully, and the times that we went our own way. Forgive our wavering discipleship and half-hearted service, and renew our commitment to live lives marked by your grace. And people of God, we are forgiven people, set free from all our past failures to make a fresh start this day and every day. The Holy Spirit empowers us to love God and to love one another. Thanks be to God for such everlasting mercy and grace. And now we join together and say our family prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. And now Ray is going to read for us from 1 Thessalonians and from Matthew.
Paul's ministry in Thessalonica. You know, brothers, that our visit to you was not a failure. We had previously suffered and been insulted in Philippi. As you know, but with the help of our God, we dared to tell you this gospel in spite of strong opposition. But the appeal we make does not spring from error or impure motives, nor are we trying to trick you. On the contrary, we speak as men approved by God, be entrusted with the gospel. We are not trying to please men, but God, who tests our hearts. You know, we never used flattery, nor did we put on a mask to cover up greed. God is our witness. We were not looking for praise from men, not from you or anyone else. As apostles of Christ, we could have been a burden to you, but we were gentle among you, like a mother caring for her little children. We loved you so much that we were delighted to share with you not only the gospel of God, but our lives as well, because you had become so dear to us. And now Matthew. The greatest commandment. Hearing that God had silenced the Sadducees, the Pharisees got together. One of them, an expert in the law, tested him with this question. Teacher, which is the greatest commandment in the law? Jesus replied, love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. And the second is like it. Love your neighbour as yourself. All the law and the prophets hang on these two commandments. Whose son is the Christ? While the Pharisees were gathered together, Jesus asked them, "What do you think about the Christ? Whose son is he?" "The son of David," they replied. He said to them, "How is it then that David, speaking by the Spirit, called him Lord? For he says, 'The Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I put your enemies under your feet.' If then David calls him Lord, how can he be his son?" No one could say a word in reply, and from that day on, no one dared to ask him any more questions. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Ray. Thank you. And we'll listen to the hymn 532, "Lord, we have come to the seashore." It doesn't really fit into the service, but I like it.
Today, so many people are able to enjoy these
I was listening to Radio 4 this morning, and again on the news, he mentioned Marcus Rashford. I don't know if you know him. He's a footballer, a young footballer. But over this lockdown period, he's been talking a lot about free school meals. I know it's Scotland with a different system, but he's been really saying the government should be taking more action in England to provide for children, especially over holidays. But again, I thought he's really been speaking out about it. And probably his legacy, maybe it will be football, maybe he'll be the most wonderful footballer ever. But certainly just now, the legacy will be in speaking out for young children from more disadvantaged backgrounds. What legacy do we leave? When we look at the Bible, so many figures in the Bible have left a tremendous legacy. There are some whose legacy is maybe not so good. We think of the Jezebels, we think of the Pilates. But certainly, Paul left a gigantic legacy as the church came into being. Now, Paul is a very complex character, very single-minded, very tireless in all his travels, sometimes abrasive, and certainly very controversial. But his teaching, his letters to all the early churches, have certainly shaped the theology and indeed the practice of the church even today. And many theologians have looked to Paul. Theologians like Martin Luther, John Calvin, John Knox. And I'm mentioning them because in some countries in the world today, like Germany and the United States, today is actually called Reformation Sunday. But they remember the Reformation. And that's because, maybe in Norway, I don't know. Yeah. And that's because it was the end of October that Martin Luther nailed his 95 theses to the door of the church in Wittenberg. But today, we read from Paul's first letter to the Thessalonians. And that's actually the earliest piece of writing we have in the New Testament, earlier than even the Gospels. And a couple of things really stood out for me. And in that passage that we read this morning. And one was that Paul suffered for his faith. He was a Roman citizen, he had a certain status, but that counted as nothing. Because he was thrown into prison, he was beaten up, he suffered for the gospel. And maybe because he suffered, maybe people listen to him all the more. But the other thing that really stood out, and it's a bit, it actually goes against some of our pictures about Paul. We tend to sometimes think of him as more confrontational. But here in Thessalonians, we're told that he was gentle with the people. And like a mother nursing her children. So this very gentle image of a mother nursing children. Very caring language, very relational language. And I think Paul realized in order to communicate the gospel, he had to draw alongside the people. He could preach all he wanted on a Sunday or whatever day he preached to them. It was how he lived day by day through the week that mattered. That would be what would convince the people about the message of the gospel, about his day-to-day life. And that's the same for all of us today. And it's certainly reflected in the gospel reading. where Jesus is asked what the greatest commandment was. And he again answered immediately to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your soul, with your whole being, 100%. But then immediately followed, and love your neighbor as yourself. In other words, how we relate to God and how we relate to one another. And it's one of these passages we nod at and say yes, but it's so difficult. So difficult to love God 100%. So difficult to love the neighbor who really rubs us up the wrong way. People can be difficult. And yet these people are made in the image of God. And we need to draw alongside them and love them. Paul gave of himself for the gospel to the point of being beaten up and thrown in jail. And we too are called to give of ourselves by loving God and by loving those around. And some have called this radical empathy. But it means working to create a good and loving and inclusive society, conscious of the care of all, and for the care of our world. It calls us to challenge situations and structures which contribute to injustice and cause pain. What will our legacy be? A big question. But right at the heart of it should be loving God and loving our neighbor. And all else will follow from that. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, one God. Amen. The hymn 718, we cannot measure how we heal. Be with us as the months of pandemic continue, and give us patience to keep each other safe, and make us attentive to the needs of those around us. We pray especially for those who find these days difficult. God of justice and leadership, we pray for our country and for all the nations of the world facing immense challenges with COVID-19. And guide all decision makers and keep the hearts of those with resources open to those who do not have enough. We pray for places where justice is lacking, where violence threatens, where leaders disappoint. Strengthen voices of wisdom, acts of compassion, to tend the needs of people most at risk. Pray for all who are anxious and suffering from mental health issues. Comfort with them with your peace. And may they hear words of calm and not chaos, words of gentleness and not confusion. We continue to remember those who are lonely or isolated. And we pray for those who mourn. Comfort all with your love. And God of grace and guidance, you call us to be your hands and your feet, your voice, your comfort in the world, following the example of Jesus. So equip us to respond to the needs around us in his name, and make us bold to get started here and now. And in a moment of quiet, we bring to you our own prayers and concerns. Lord, hear these and all our prayers in Jesus' name. Amen. And our closing hymn is a hymn 130, Ye Servants.
And God bless you all.